Oh, sorry. I didn't realize you were plugged in. I'm always doing that to people.
Jesus said, I am the light of the world.
Amen.
Our announcements today are the Green Mountain Chapel closed for 2 weeks because of COVID. If anyone here went to a recent event there, you might want to be tested. Opportunities to serve here. The Deacon Board is planning to restart our children's programs sometime in September. This will include child care for children under 5 in the play area and nursery, and a Sunday teaching program for the older children. We are gathering a team of interested individuals for either area of the children's ministry and want to have enough volunteers to allow us to rotate teachers and caregivers. If you're interested in volunteering, please contact Elder Russell Rolla. The food shop is in need of general volunteers. And today, right after our service, after our coffee hour, we will be going to Payne's Beach on North Windsor Street to baptize BJ. And we encourage anyone who knows BJ to come to the river. To come to the river. And bear witness to this step that he is taking. Maggie and Joseph and their family made it to British Columbia and are settled in. Maggie has sent an email to our church, and you'll find that in your bulletin. All of these announcements are in our bulletin. Sabbatical celebration for Pastor Josh. Pastor Josh will be formally back to the church on Sunday, October 3rd, and we will be having a special Sunday service celebrating his return and hearing from him about his time on sabbatical. Pastor Josh and his family may be returning to the parsonage in mid-September since the children will be in school. But we ask that you allow him to complete his sabbatical at home until October. If you have any spiritual or practical needs, please continue to reach out to our elders. All right. Looks like the end of the announcements. I want to pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you so much, and we are here for you and because of you. And in a few moments, our women's Bible study group choir is going to come and sing. They're going to open worship for us, Lord. I thank you for these women, for their hunger for you, Jesus, and that they stood fast for the whole book of James. And from out of that, you have raised a ministry of music. We pray for every heart here, Lord God, that we would just take this moment and come before you and open our hearts and confess anything that might stand in the way right now between us coming into worship with you. We're going to take just a few seconds, Lord, to make sure we enter this sanctuary with clean hands and pure hearts. Thank you, Lord, for your reminders. Now I'd like to invite the Women's Bible Study Group Choir beautiful song, and thank you for opening us up and providing the call to worship. We're going to open now with our confession of faith.
Just a minute.
We'll be saying the Apostles' Creed together in just a moment. Felicia wants to finish up right there. Please stand for the Apostles' Creed. If you can't stand, that's fine. The Apostles' Creed is our, it just walks us through what we believe. It's all it is, a statement of faith. Every sentence is a statement of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, even after we have accepted Jesus as our precious Savior, it's easy for our old destructive beliefs to echo in our mind. Some of us might hear ourselves saying, I'm a failure, I'm not good enough, I don't do enough, I don't have enough. Some of us might think that if you would just give us that one thing that we really want, then we would feel okay. We would feel okay about ourselves. Dear Heavenly Father, please use our service today to specifically reassure us of your love for us, that you will never leave us or forsake us. Show us how to live today, Lord, so that we will not perish from a lack of knowledge, but instead become loving and free enough to carry out your perfect will for our lives. Thank you. And Amos will now usher us into our time of prayer together. The song will be Sweet Hour of Prayer, and you can either sit or stand, whatever you like to do to optimize your position of worship.
And
be seated. I'm now going to enter our time of prayer using what Pastor Josh taught us. It's the ACTS, A-C-T-S. A for adoration, C for confession, T for thanksgiving, and S for supplication. And I've asked Amos to play music for us just gently and quietly while we go to the Lord. I really want to welcome every one of you here. I care about you very much, and you have helped me to be able to stand just as a person since I started coming. Heavenly Father, we adore you. And we're going to do this prayer in silence in our seats. But Father, I often don't know what it means to adore you. What does that word mean? So I've written it out, what it means to me. And hopefully this can help anybody who might have had the same difficulty. I spelled out the word adore, Lord God. A, adore. A, Abba Father. You are our Abba Father. You will never leave us nor forsake us. You have adopted us. You are the Alpha and Omega. We adore you. You are our beginning and our end, Lord. You are the Alpha and Omega. D, you are our daily bread, Lord God. You provide every need that we need, and you show us how to live and how to take care of things through you when they are things that we want. You are our daily bread. We adore you. Oh, you are the one true God. Your power is real, Lord. When you speak, it's the truth. There's no other God but you, Lord God. You are A-D-O-R-E, R. You are Rapha, Jehovah Rapha. You are our healer. And you are present here today to heal. You're here today to heal sickness, to heal broken hearts, to heal fear, to heal uncertainty. You are Jehovah Rohi. You are our shepherd. You will guide us today with your rod and your staff. Yes, how can a rod be comforting? You make it comforting, Lord, even when you push us with it a little. It is still that rod and thy staff. Your staff supports us, and you comfort us with both. E, you are the everlasting arms beneath us, Lord. We know you're here today. We know that the people who are here today have an appointment with you, and a special appointment. Just like the first day of BJ's arrival here, it was a special appointment. And today, we get to baptize BJ here. But BJ has been ministered to by Pastor Josh. Pastor Josh sowed life into this young man's heart through you, Jesus. And now we get to do the next part, which is to join in the baptism of BJ. We welcome his family here, Lord. We adore you for doing this work. Now, Lord, we're going to take another moment for confession. We're going to take a personal inventory here again. We're going to ask you to show us where we were wrong, and we will promptly admit it. And we will thank you, Holy Spirit, for shining a light on our hearts so that we can stand before you, Lord, with clean hands and a pure heart today. Let's take a minute in silence for confession. Give thanks to you now, Lord. thanks to you that we have a drawer to put our socks in, that we have a job that we can buy the socks with. Lord God, that cleaning our socks drawer could just be the one thing we need to get our mind off our fear and our concerns. Washing the dishes. We're thanking, Lord, that we have dishes to wash. We thank you that we have food to wash off those plates, Lord. And now we enter into a cycle of thanksgiving, Lord, from the deepest hearts of this congregation before you. I asked Elder Russell if I could use the format that he used last week for supplication. And he said yes, so I'm going to do what Elder Russell did last week. Many of us today are carrying something that is a real burden. We have needs within our lives that are sometimes too difficult to put into words. That sometimes we just need God to remember us and once again remind us that He stands beside us. So if that describes you, I'm going to ask you to just stand where you are in the pew, acknowledging that you need this congregation to stand with you. We don't need to know what it is to lift you in prayer to God. So as we pray silently, stand quietly now, and we together will uphold you especially in prayer. God brings us together so we don't have to carry heavy things all by ourselves. Each member of this congregation and those who are standing calling out for more, those who are standing who want to leave nothing undone. You are our burden bearer. Please reassure us that your presence is with us in real and tangible ways now and throughout this week. In the name of Jesus, we ask you to help us remove anything that burdens or oppresses or harasses us. Please set us free so that we may see your love in new ways. In the name of Jesus, help us to remove any barrier that stands in the way of our relationship with you. Any barrier that keeps us from laying hold of all that you have created us to be. In the name of Jesus, give each of us your new hope and remove from us discouragement or hesitation. In the name of Jesus, restore those of us who are sick and give us your fullness of life. And we pray in the name of Jesus to provide those things that we have need of today. We are trusting, Lord, in your care. And we thank you, and we close this time of prayer in Jesus' name, and we enter in together to say the prayer that you taught us all to say, Lord, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Thank you. We are going to now have the prayer for the reading and proclamation of God's word. And we are going to have a scripture reading of the scripture today. And I'm inviting Mr. and Mrs. Kent and Sarah Araldi to do that ministry, to do that service for us.
Lord, thank you that you are our shepherd. Thank you for leading us, restoring us, and guiding us.
Psalm 23, the Psalm of David, the King. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Thank you, Kent and Sarah. And now I would like to invite Mrs. Kathy Roloff to come do our children's message. Thank you, Kathy.
Morning.
Morning.
Hey, this side's filling up a little bit. You guys are still scared. You have to come closer. How many people have clocks like this in their house? How many children have never seen a clock like this and don't know how to read it? Right? Because a lot of times we have clocks, you push a button and the time just comes up. Anyway, this is a story about a clock. A little bit. When I was 10 years old, I had at that time, there were 8 children in our family. The oldest was 13, the youngest was 2, and I was 10. And we were sitting out on our porch, and as was a habit, the neighbor next door came over to visit, who we were very close to. And at one point, my mother said to me, "Kathy, go in and tell me what time it is." So I did. I looked at the clock, and I came out, and I said, "The big hand on the 6 and the little hand on the 10. And my mother said, "Very funny, go back in and tell me what time it is." So I went back in and was a little bit farther along, but it still looked like it was pretty much the little hand was on the 10 and the big hand was on the 6. And my mother started crying because she realized that I did not know how to tell time. No clue, no idea. I have 11 of these in my house because of that, but that's another story. Affected me. And the reason I didn't know how to tell time is they didn't teach us at school, because I would have remembered. But there were 8 children in the house. When we got up in the morning, we all got up. When it was time to eat, we all went to eat. When the car left, we got in it. There wasn't a whole lot of me ever having to know the time. I just had to be there, and I was there. So I missed that thing about telling time. And that's the beauty of when you're a child. When you're a child, you really are not aware of all of the things that are in place to keep you safe. You don't go to the grocery store and buy groceries. You don't pay the rent. You turn the light switch, the lights come on. You go to bed, you have a pillow and blanket. You run out of socks, you get new ones, right? And the people that are in charge of that are your parents, people that love you. And they supply all of your needs, and you really can just enjoy being a child, which can be really fun and can be really hard. And when it's hard, you still have these people that love you, that can surround you and talk to you. Fast forward 15 years from 10, and now I'm 25, married with 3 kids, and I have switched places. I'm not the sheep being taken care of. I'm kind of in charge. And I, along with Russ, we have to make sure that the bills are paid, and we have to make sure that there's food on the table. And if somebody's sick in the middle of the night, We're the ones walking back and forth. We're sitting in the bathroom with the shower on for the kid that always gets croup. And the list goes on and on of what you do as a parent, which you know if you're a parent. And even if you're not a parent, if you've ever babysat or been married, you know that you still are very much responsible for other people. Your life is not your own. I want to say that being a parent was never a chore. It was always a joy. And I also want to say that it didn't mean it was easy. And in this switching from being taken care of to being someone that took care of somebody, I was made even more aware of the Lord being my shepherd. Because that's where I ran. That's where I knelt all the time. Help me, help me, help me. Forgive me, forgive me, forgive me. And so we're going to, we already read the 23rd Psalm, but that's what we're going to talk about. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And you're going to be in different places in your life. Sometimes you're going to be the sheep. Sometimes you're going to be kind of the shepherd. But the thing you have to remember that as time passes, and it will, there's really only one shepherd that we're all relating to help us get through this life.
Thank you, Kathy, as usual. In the church, this is called the ordinary time. Usually we wear a green stole. We wear different stoles for different times of the year. Baptism is white. Marriage is white. I am wearing purple today for a reason. Purple is for requiem. It's for death. And today, I hope this message will help all of us to put to death the things that harass us. The things that are like a knife stabbing in our heart. I'm going to read the outcome of this sermon first. I'm going to read the end of it first, because this is where we're going, and this is where I hope that we can really put to death some of the areas where the enemy harasses us and our children and our families. Be not far from me, O Lord. Psalm 35:22. All right. God created us to need oxygen. Jim Proctor told us that 2 or 3 weeks ago when he was singing, "This is the air I breathe." He had us all hold our breath. God created these needs. He created us to need oxygen, safety, and belonging. Those are only three. In medicine, we call those Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And I have a friend who says his favorite thing in the world is oxygen. We're going to address the need to belong today, the need to be loved, the need to fit in. Ephesians 1:5 says that God adopted us. So he must have known something back then when he adopted us. Because he made Maslow's hierarchy of needs. I want you to say to yourself today, actually let's do it out loud. I'm going to ask you what to say first. I'm going to do it first, and then we're going to do it together. I am enough, I have enough, I do enough. All together. I am enough, I have enough, I do enough. The things that trouble us are found in the seven deadly sins. And they're called deadly because they are behaviors or feelings that inspire further sin. The feeling of want, the one that stabs us in the heart, is rooted in low self-esteem and associated with the fear of abandonment. The seven deadly sins in order are this: lust, envy, gluttony, wrath, and sloth. I'm going to pull out a couple of them. False pride. Never feeling that I'm enough or that I have enough. Afraid to be the real me. Afraid to be vulnerable. Greed. Never enough. The constant feeling of emptiness. Am I ever good enough? Is anything ever enough? Why am I never content? Envy or jealousy. If only I had that magic thing, then my life would be okay. Then people would think I'm okay. Gluttony. Never enough. Stuff the pain. Too much feeling. Stuff it down. Constant feeling of emptiness. The food is never going to fill me up. Neither will anything else. Alcohol, spending, nothing. And finally, remember anger. And I want you to know this, that the main ingredients of unresolved anger are grief and sadness. And that's where I work. I work in the grief and sadness. I work where there's suicide, where there's hopelessness, where there's addiction. And this word of God, this is what brings hope to the hopeless. Sloth and laziness. Now, how would this fit in? Fear of sloth or laziness may cause me to be overzealous. The weight of overextended responsibility may be the only way that I can feel valuable and worthwhile. Do I know where to stop before my drive turns into self-abuse? And then finally, all right, we know the stuff now. We're getting a handle on it. We know God loves us. We know that He's adopted us. So, okay, I'm going to start setting my boundaries with people and start, you know, taking care of my temple. All right, so I set a boundary and boom, blowback. Blowback. You're going to be called names that you've never heard before. You're going to be... My expectation of you is that you don't make this boundary. This blowback can put you back on your heels. But I'm here to tell you, teach yourselves and your children how to set boundaries. And even more than that, teach them how to take the blowback when it happens. And this is what it looks like when you are God's child and now you've set a boundary. And the blowback comes. This is your first attempt, okay? To take care of your temple. And there's blowback. And then we look up to God and we say, is this all there is for me? Is abandonment all there is for me when I try to set a healthy boundary for myself? Is this all I have? But then the Spirit of God will rise up in you. Because He's there. He wants you in this place. And then we say to God, no, no more. I'm not having it. This want and fear is low self-esteem. And I don't have low self-esteem anymore. I refuse to have those feelings inside of me. And God said, that's right. You don't have low self-esteem anymore because you know that I love you. And that is the end of that first experience of getting blowback. Just cry out to God. Is this all I have? No. Let him go. Let him walk out. Let him kick you off the job. If you have done everything and you have taken care of every offense, with people and with God, you are a righteous person in the name of Jesus. Now, what does this have to do with Psalm 23, you may ask? All right. Psalm 23, verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He's going to give us everything good. But in the meantime, we have 100 years to work out the things that we want. And the want is the jealousy, the envy, the greed, the gluttony, and the anger. It's trying to fill what Kathy taught us about, I think last week or so, that the rice pocket, the pocket in our heart that is empty, and we try to fill it up with stuff, but we are never satisfied, we are never content. The Lord says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. So we're going to put these wants where they belong, right there at the foot of the cross. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. It's not a suggestion. He makes us lie down. What has made you lie down? Did you lose someone you loved? Have you just gotten a terrible diagnosis? Has there been a horrible event that happened in you and your family? Or is it these old tapes in the head that say, if I just had that magic thing, they would all know I'm okay. Or, I'm so angry. But God says, remember that anger, the root of it is grief and sadness. Do not be ashamed if you're angry. It's a red flag. Somewhere in your heart, you've been hurt. And this word tells us how to take care of that. He leads me beside the still waters. What are those? It's not Niagara Falls. It's not the Atlantic. It's not the Pacific. It's also not a stagnant pond. It's the clear, sparkling, refreshing river of waters coming from the Sacred Heart of Christ. He leads me beside still waters. He doesn't push me in. He leads me. He did make me lie down. If he's made you lie down, there's a reason. And it's not because you are worthless. It's because you are worthful. He restores my soul. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. What does a restored soul look like? It looks like me up here. It looks like Kathy. No matter how she feels, she comes up and she gives a children's message. It looks like Tim and Carol. They're always here. He's the one who picks up the cigarette butts outside. It's Ken and Sarah who got here today just for this ministry. It's Sue Trottier at the food shelf. It's Jerry downstairs making sure the coffee's made. It's Joanne every Sunday in there praying for the service. It's Amos showing up today. It's Felicia in the back. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. All right? So he's restored our soul. What is the path of righteousness? And it's plural. The paths of righteousness. It's what our duty is. It's what God has put in our life for our calling. What's your calling? That's your path. And every single morning, it's going to be a different path, but it will be with the same title. If you haven't been entitled as a brain surgeon, God's not going to ask you to do brain surgery. But if you have been gifted and your call is to smile at someone, then when you go to Walmart, that's your path of righteousness that day, to smile at the first person you see. And I bet 100% of the time they'll smile back at you. That is the path of righteousness. When we put our feet down on the floor in the morning, we can say, remember, okay, Lord, I'm putting my feet down. I'm on the path of righteousness. Which way is it going to take me today? It's right there. And it's for his name's sake. This banner up here, it doesn't say anybody's name. God is Jehovah Nissi. He is my banner. His banner, it's Jesus. When we work for him, we hide behind the cross. But we're not working for him. Everyone in this room has your own path of righteousness. What is your calling? What are you studying in school? Do you see kids who might be bullied or afraid? Ask God for the courage to befriend them. There's a calling in your life. So many of us get to this stage in our life and we don't know what it is, but you know what it is. It's that one thing that you could do forever, even if you were burned out and you wouldn't even have to be paid for it. That's the calling. Are you a farmer? Do you clean houses? Are you a nurse? Do you work at the food shelf? It's for his name's sake, Jehovah Nissi, the banner over us, Jehovah Nissi, God our banner. This part can be a little tough. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Verse 4. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Reading this, it seems like we're always in the valley of the shadow of death, just coming out of it, or we can see one ahead. So it's this cycle that I think is going to stay with us from the time we take our first breath until the time we take our last. The valley of the shadow of death, it's just a shadow. It can be painful in there. It can be very scary in there. And I bet everybody in this room has been there. It's the valley of the shadow of death, but I'm not sitting down in it. I'm not lying down in it. I'm walking through it. And it says the shadow. What does that mean? A shadow is just a shadow. Jesus is the light. He is what's causing that shadow. He is walking with us through the valley of the shadow of death. And we are to fear no evil, for thy rod and thy staff, they will comfort me. And I want to say one more thing. This stuff, you have to work for it. We have to surrender to God to win, which is a paradox. But we don't get any of this stuff without work. And the work is on our knees. That's where the Holy Spirit will touch us and speak to us and guide us and direct us. And put on the whole armor of God. That is not in the Bible just because it sounds neat. We put on the helmet of salvation. Because the enemy's arrows just wants to obliterate our mind and keep us in jealousy, fear, anger, and want for the rest of our lives. The helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, is Jesus. When God looks at us, he sees Jesus. He doesn't see anything else but Jesus. That is the breastplate of righteousness, the girdle of truth. We wear the girdle of truth. This is the truth, this is the girdle, and we wear it. And our shoes, our feet, are shod with the gospel of peace. That means we're not going to gossip about people, we're not going to cut people down. We're going to reason things out together. And boy, does that take armor. In our hand is the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. This hand has the shield of faith. On our tongue is a continual prayer. That's what the Bible says. Continual prayer is part of the armor of God. And then from the Old Testament, he reminds us that he is our rear guard and his everlasting arms are holding us up. Now, how long did it take for us right now to put on that armor? That's all it takes. And if we can remember that every day, every morning, before we put our feet on the path of righteousness, we have a chance. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. This is verse 5. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. Our enemies can be depression, despair, that abject feeling of abandonment. Our enemies can be that sucking feeling of want and jealousy and envy and fear and anger. Those are our enemies. And our shepherd sees that. And if we call on his name and we kneel before him and we surrender, then he will prepare a table before us in the presence of our enemies. And yes, sometimes our enemies can be people. They can be people who've never opened a door for you, but God will open that door if he wants to open it. But he's not going to open it unless we're on our knees saying, we don't want it. If you don't want it, I don't want it. Because if I get what I want, Lord, and it's not of you, then I am in big trouble. And when we see God prepare a table before us in the presence of our enemies, do not gloat. We will see it. You're not going to be able to miss it because it's a miracle. Don't gloat because God will take his hand off our enemies. So you can say, okay, God, I see that, and I'm not gloating. I just want you to know I see it. And then you get back to your duty, back to the path of righteousness for that day. My cup runs over. You anoint my head with oil. He anoints all your bumps and bruises. He puts the balm of Gilead on your broken heart. He sends somebody to talk to you when you're in such grief that you can barely stay alive. That's his anointing oil. He anoints my head with oil. The shepherd takes that little sheep and he anoints his little woolly ears and gets them all taken care of after he's really blown it. You anoint my head with oil and my cup runs over. What does that look like? The cup runs over. There's no want in that cup. When your cup runs over, then you can grab a pen and a card and send somebody an encouraging note because your cup runs over. When your cup runs over, you can send somebody an email. Hope you're doing okay today. I was thinking of you. When your cup runs over, you fill in the blanks. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So, little goodness and mercy are the two little sheepdogs nipping at our heels, making sure we stay on that path today of righteousness. But we know, really, that God's goodness and mercy is a lot bigger than that. It's big. It's big. Where do we find it? Right here on our knees. Acknowledge him in all your ways, and he will direct your path. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I go to prepare a place for you, Jesus said. There's mansions there. And did you know that if you drill right down to the Greek, mansions means comfort. And what does comfort mean? Who's associated with comfort? Our Holy Spirit. Thank you. Now we're going to have Amos come. And you can sit down. You can kneel down. You can come to the altar. You can stand up. Whatever you want to do. Whatever you want to do to receive the fullest blessing today of your relationship now with the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. Whatever it takes for you to feel hope. To let the music that Amos is going to lead us in to touch your spirit. And that you will connect with our Holy Spirit. And your way will become clear.
Even though Remember your faithfulness, God. We will remember through the trials, God.
Thank you.
of our lives. As we seek spiritual solutions to the old, dependent hungers of the flesh, we discover that we will intuitively know how to handle situations which used to baffle us. We will suddenly realize that God is doing for us what we could not do for ourselves. Please repeat after me. I am enough.
I am enough.
I do enough.
I do enough.
I have enough.
I have enough.
I have been crucified.
I have been crucified.
With Christ.
With Christ.
It is no longer I who live.
It is no longer I who live.
But Christ lives in me.
But Christ lives in me.
And the life which I now live in the flesh.
And the life which I now live in the flesh.
I live by faith.
I live by faith.
In the Son of God.
In the Son of God.
Who loves me.
Who loves me.
And gave himself for me.
And gave himself for me.
Thank you. May the Lord bless you today. May he bless the work of your hands. May you call on him to keep your feet on the paths of righteousness that have your name on them. And we close this time thanking you, Lord. And we ask you to bless your people. Bless your people. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace. Yes. I'm so glad you remembered that.
Jesus said,